6:30, so I would like to call this meeting to order. If you would all stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
That was awesome.
Thank you and welcome, everyone. It's a packed house in here tonight. So to start us off, I will take a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Souser, second by Cordes. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Agenda is set. So we are going to start off with good news. I'll turn it over to Superintendent Haugen for that.
All right. Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board, and our spectacular audience tonight. Just a few quick things. First, this school board meeting unfortunately fell right after last week, which was paraprofessional week. And so Tim Walz, Governor Walz, did proclaim it paraprofessional week last week. There are over 28,000 paraprofessionals in Minnesota working hard every day to make sure every child has the education they need to succeed in school and life. We want to thank them for their hard work and recognize their efforts and contributions. Especially want to then recognize in our own school district, we have approximately 150 paraprofessionals. And much of the support that our students get and much of the work that happens, especially a lot individually, happens through our paraprofessionals. So thank them for all the added learning we have in our school district because of their work. Next, the Farmington Special Education Department and the Minnesota Council for Exceptional Children hosted its second annual SPED camp on March 2nd at Bachman Middle School. This was a free professional development opportunity that gave basically renewal credits provided by the council. We had 60 participants over the course of the day from around the region. The focus was on special education and special education related services. This was a day that staff volunteered on a Saturday to come in for. Then it's also one that got local support because lunch was provided through Cub and Quick Trip and Hy-Vee. So very good day, happy that we were able to host that. Finally, something really cool. Our congratulations to Xander Smamby, MinCaps and Farmington High School student. MinCaps is a professional program that students in 11th and 12th grade can go over to Lakeville for half a day and work in a real business or medical field environment and really get hands-on experience in those careers. And so because of that, Xander earned the Scholes Innovation Scholarship from St. Thomas. This includes 4 years of tuition, seed money to start his business idea, and an office in Minneapolis. What a major accomplishment for this future leader. It's important to note this was our first year that our students were able to go to the MinCaps program, and we already have had that success. I know that Prior Lake had a student who had a similar story, and next year we'll be sending maybe up to three times as many students to that program. So a lot more of those amazing stories to come.
Awesome. Thank you, Jay. I'll just let you continue with your superintendent update.
Thank you once again. I'm going to abbreviate a little bit because the real story is sitting out there in the audience. We really want to get and listen to our students and our staff. But I'll just say, last week was a very interesting week. There's some really cool things that went on about our district. I wasn't here one day last week because I was out talking about us. First, Mr. Jason Berg and I went to North Dakota because North Dakota is going after the kind of education we're trying to provide in our school district. The idea of competency base, that there are things that you all need to know outside of the academic things that actually lead to great success in life. And we can put those into competencies and say, if you leave with these things, you have a much better chance of having a great, successful life. And so we're going after those in Minnesota, but in North Dakota it was really fun. We have been doing this work for some time, so they invited us to help a whole bunch of school districts there. But they're doing this work because their state is 100% in favor of this kind of learning, is right from like their commissioner of education, everyone in the department, they were all there helping out, and even, and their governor as well, and policymakers. So it's really cool when everyone's working together. And so we in Farmington are recognized as leading the way in doing those sort of things. But part of what we've been working so hard at is to get hard on is to get our leaders in the state, policymakers, the governor and the commissioner, to help support these. And at this point right now, the state Senate is supporting this work. And as I understand it, the House is yet to hear the bill that would allow our school district and other school districts in our state to do this much faster, much deeper, and with much more support. So our legislature is really important in the work that we all do. It touches all of us. So anyone knowing a legislature, competency-based education, allowing our staff, and it's our staff who are trying to do this, you know, that it would be an immense help and support. All to say, we continue, as you know, many of you know, we have a lot of folks who come visit from other school districts then to, they always say they can come and see you. They say that they see the future of education. So they come see where they want to go. And today we had people here from Inver Grove Heights, which is maybe only 20 miles or 15 miles north of us. And next week we have folks coming in from New York and Boston, organization that helps school districts across the country, and they keep hearing about us. So they want to come in and see what we're doing. So again, we're always doing tours, and many of you have probably seen people come through who want to see what's happening in our district. So it's a really, those are proud moments for our school district, and I'm again always so eternally glad to serve all of you and your tremendous work. So thanks for everyone here and what they do.
Thank you, Jay. Next, we'll do our student school board member updates.
All right. So first off, I just want to say thank you to all of my peers that came out tonight. You guys had some amazing projects out there, and it really makes me excited on where Farmington is going with how bright-minded you guys are. It makes me excited to see what you're going to be like when you're my age, and I can't wait to come back when I'm in college and see how well you guys are doing in school. It's really cool to see what you're doing. But on another hand, the high school just finished finals, and everyone is really excited for third trimester. All the teachers are really excited, and it's really cool to see the new energy that a new trimester brings. And the energy isn't only in the high school. I know it passes down to the middle schools and everything, because we have tutors and different students that go to elementary schools and middle schools. I'm a part of tutoring at the middle school, and it's just cool to have that energy spread throughout the whole district, even though it's in one building. And that's one thing that I really like about Farmington. It's very connected, and one student bodies affect each other throughout the district. It's not just one school. Another thing is Mr. Pickens this Friday, I believe he's going to a conference meeting in Minneapolis for student-centered learning. We're part of a group. The group likes to refer to it as a web of schools throughout our area, and it's really focused on student-centered learning, what we're really going after, like Mr. Haugen said. And hopefully with my principal going there, we're going to be able to help connect our school and other schools to even further what you guys are doing right now at your grade level. We're going to be able to do it in every grade level and connect all the schools and make sure that we're really getting the student-centered learning that we want. So on that note,
Also, I just want to say thank you, just like what Jack said, with everyone who's here today. And with the student voice team, just like what I've said the last meeting, we've talked about more mental health concerns, because there are some students who's really depressed or stressed out with what they've been doing from about like school stuff. And also with that meeting, we've also talked about students participating in three actions, which is what he listed as to cultivate a holistic education system that unifies community members, parents, staff, and students. Second one would be to ensure the individual agency conducive to student-driven learning. And the last one would be to exude a presence that exhibits our uniqueness and indispensability. Also, we will be starting to visit schools. We haven't set a date yet, but Principal Pickens, Jack, and I are working on it. Thank you.
Awesome, thank you. I'll be interested to hear the updates from the school visits that you guys do. All right, next up is our consent agenda. The consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and it will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? All right, seeing none, I will entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the above consent agenda.
I'll second.
Motion by Carrero, second by Coletta. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, consent agenda is approved. Then moving on to reports and communications, we have a number of buildings here to present some highlights that the students and staff are doing. So do we want to start with Aiken Road, or is there a list? Does anybody want to volunteer to go first?
Yeah, Riverview Elementary is going
first. All right, Riverview is going to go first. That works.
I might have a mutant in her hands while all those
okay.
Nights are
trying to figure it out.
All right. I am Dr. Grimes. I'm actually the principal at Riverview Elementary School, and I brought my third grade team and a group of students here to talk to you about the Gingerbread Community Project.
Hi, I'm Shelly Fortita.
Tracy Hens.
Emily Fai.
Angie Asher Carlson.
Can you hear them okay, or do you want them to stand behind the mic?
We might have them stand by the mic so that everybody can hear them.
All right, so when it's your slide, you're gonna let me just come over here, okay? All right, so we worked together as a grade level and created a gingerbread community project that we had learned about through the Twitter community. And so this is, the kids are gonna tell you about our project. All right.
First, we got to research our buildings that we wanted to work on, which was really fun. For an example, I did the grand elevator. For my opinion, it was fun to work on.
Christian. Do you remember? What did we do? Does anybody else want to take this one? Got it?
Next, we started researching the location, and then we started sketching it, and then we Google Earth to sketch it, and then we wrote opinions about it, about why that part of the building was important to the setting. City.
Okay, good.
Parents donated a bunch of boxes, candy, graham crackers, frosting, and time.
Christian, this is you.
Then we started building our gingerbread houses. First, we used boxes, and then we taped it all into shape.
Wow.
She's talking about all the candy.
Next,
next, with all the parents' donations of candies and all that, we started decorating and looking back on Google Earth and seeing all the decorations and things on them.
We stuck all the graham crackers together to form our building, and we decorated it with frosting and all these other goodies that the parents have donated.
I think it's cool how our kind teacher set up the building where they went in our real Farmington city. Cause then when people come and look at our gingerbread community, it will be all in order. Thank you.
Kristen or Riley, one of the two. To the other city?
Oh, yeah.
Can you tell them about that?
We Skyped with a city in Kansas, and they had a similar project to us, so we showed them ours, and they showed us theirs.
After this, Gateway
from Riverview came, and we shared our projects with them and also other Riverview students. And then we had a play, and then the parents, they came and we showed them our projects. And then after that, so up in the top, it's me and someone from Castle Rock Bank. So when I finished, I made Castle Rock Bank from Farmington, and then a few people, we actually drove to the actual Castle Rock Bank, and I gave it to him. And then down in the bottom, there's a note. They thanked me, and they sent us a note and a picture because they set it out so everyone that went to the bank could see it. And then
we also went to the cakery and, of course, here, and we delivered those too. And here's, we were standing now in this beautiful place in Farmington.
Then after that, this girl, Bridget, our grade, she brought wings, and then that's what we had for lunch for like a surprise. As a thank you.
As in luck for us, we got a TV station and a reporter, and recorded this video on the news from our gingerbread community. And here's the video.
Do you want to add anything else?
We're just glad to like be in this Farmington community and be able to make it out of gingerbread houses.
All right, so they really wanted to show you our video. Our 30 seconds or 3 minutes of fame. It might be. Hershey Kisses, bugles, like all kinds of pretzels.
It's a class project that's too pretty to eat.
We decorated it with a whole bunch of candy.
But these gingerbread houses took a lot more work than just frosting and gumdrops. More than 100 third graders were given the assignment to choose a building in Farmington, study it, and build it.
I made the T.C. Davis house with my partner Samantha.
Lucy and her partner built a historic bed and breakfast in town. It's one of 52 buildings that these third graders built.
We're really kind of into project-based learning here, and so wanted to connect different standards and make it fun and exciting for the holiday.
The students got to show off their projects to parents and students on their last day at school before break Friday. Then they got to deliver their sweet creations to the places that inspired them.
What do you have? Oh my gosh, that's gorgeous.
This gingerbread house got delivered to Sweet Needs. The Farmington Bakery building has been there for more than 8 decades.
It looks just like the bakery.
Yes.
It's perfect.
What was your favorite part about doing this?
Using pretzels to make an emergency exit.
And even if there were a few construction mishaps along the way, the students start the new year with something much sweeter than just decorating skills.
So I think it's made them more aware of the community and what's here.
The students were able to show off their project and their city to a class in Kansas via Skype. They may also have the opportunity to Skype with a class in Canada, even maybe Lithuania. Reporting in Farmington, Kate Raditz, WCCO 4 News.
All right.
So we got very cool. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
I absolutely love this project. What a great way to get the kids involved in our community, learn about the buildings, and, you know, I think it was a wonderful idea. Great project, guys. Really good job.
I just want to say to the teachers and the parents that facilitated this, it's really amazing what you guys did here, and thank you to the parents that donated all this stuff. It's really cool to see the community come together to create a community. And it helps give the kids and the students the sense of community, Skyping to different places and being able to talk with different people and show off Farmington and really take pride in being Farmington. And to the students, that's really cool. You guys did an amazing job, so. Good job.
One quick question for the students. When you Skyped with that classroom in Kansas, right? So they did a gingerbread community as well. So what parts of their community was different or similar to ours? Were there anything that was like, oh, that's strange or that's cool?
This was in December before.
Sure, it was a few months ago, wasn't it?
It was way bigger.
Oh, really?
It was a bigger,
way bigger.
Okay.
And
okay.
One of the things when we laid out them, since it's the Farmington, we didn't just lay them out anywhere. We actually, the teachers, they made like a map, but we didn't hang it up. But they looked at the map, and they didn't just lay out the gingerbreads wherever. They actually made it look like the actual Farmington, like so they wouldn't put like. They didn't just put somewhere, like, anything by anything. They made it, like, the actual Farmington. And they added, like, street signs, like...
That you guys made.
Yeah, so some of us made in art class.
Anyone else say
your favorite parts?
What?
Say your favorite parts.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all from Riverview. All right, it looks like we're going to have Farmington Elementary up next. Okay, I lied. We're going to have Aiken Road up. I'm just going by what's on the board right there. We got lots of tabs, though, so. Oh, boy.
All right, we're from Aiken Road Elementary. We're the multi-age, grades 1 through 4. I'm Kelly Kelly, I teach 3rd and 4th grade.
I'm Shonda Wasick, I teach 3rd and 4th grade.
I'm Linda Rayola, and I teach 1st and 2nd.
And I'm Julie Heckman, and I also teach 1st and 2nd. And we are here to share with you about our multi-age play that we put on in January. Our multi-age is made up of 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th grade. And the students tried out for parts, and they had to memorize their parts. And we did some STEM learning about castles, and they worked in groups to build castles that were also presented at the play. And to bring in the community, the people who came to watch the play brought in newer, gently used books that we were able to donate back to our community. And so I'm going to stop talking and turn it over to our actors and actresses here as they share a little bit about their learning. Okay?
Hi, my name is Autumn Rick, and I'm in fourth grade. And the play that we did this year was called A Night at Dawn. And usually before I was in Maltage, I didn't really like going up and talking in front of a big groups of people or like memorizing parts really. But after doing these plays in third grade and fourth grade, I actually realized that I like doing the art of drama. And it was just really fun and growth in between and learning more like fluency with memorizing words and just talking in front of a lot of people. And it just was a lot of fun.
Hi, my name is Melody Lego and I'm in fourth grade, and I really liked the play because before I didn't really like to talk with fluency and I didn't really like to talk with big groups. And after the plays I've done with in multi-age, and I just learned how to speak in front of large groups, and I remembered all my lines, and I was actually very happy about that. And so, and I liked that everyone had a part in the play, even if it was very small. They each had a part in the play, and without their part in the play, it would be like nothing.
My name is Logan Smith, and I really like the play because I got to make a big picture of the Night at Dawn that was set up outside of the gym for everybody to see. So I really liked that part.
Hi, my name is Brayden, and I really liked the play. It was fun, and it was hard talking to a big crowd, so I just pretended there was no people.
Hi, my name is Theo Hall, and my part in the play was Squinty, and all I really did was walk around with two other characters named Mustache and Red, and I liked the play because I got to know new people and make new friends that I maybe never knew about.
Hello, my name is Nora Francine, and I'm in second grade. And I like the play because we learned fluency and how to do words, because we each had to pick a word that we didn't know that was part of the play, and then we had to find out the definition and where it was in the play.
Hi, my name is Lily Tobin, and my personal growth was in my confidence, because before I didn't really like to speak in front of big audiences, and after the play I like to do it.
Hello, my name is McKenna Bechtel, and I really liked the play because I learned how to speak in front of a big crowd, and I learned how to be confident, and I really liked it, and it was very fun.
Hi, my name is Lauren. I learned in the play that speaking is something that's really big.
So this was about a 6-week process that we all worked together. And as I had stated earlier, we really included some great history lessons in this, as well as combining our groups together to build scenery. We took a look at where every student was at, what they enjoyed doing. We had some music, we had a little bit of dancing, a lot of acting going on, and it was just a great opportunity for the students to work together, to share their leadership, learn from one another, and then give back to the school through some outstanding acting. So thank you.
Thank you, guys. Anyone have any comments?
I just want to say, keep hearing how shy you guys were in front of big audiences. I commend you, because it's tough to get up here and speak, and you guys were not shy at all, so great job on that. Looks like we have some great actors and actresses out there, so I test you guys a little bit to come to more meetings and speak on what's going on in the schools. I mean, you guys make our meetings fun, so I appreciate that.
Awesome. All right, thank you, guys.
Thank you.
And guests. Now I think Farmington Elementary. No. Okay, I was wrong again. North Trail Elementary's up. All right.
Good evening. I have some fifth graders here. I'm one of the fifth grade teachers, Lisa Thompson, over at North Trail. And we've worked on a few projects over the past trimester. One is on civil rights. The kids did an interdisciplinary unit, so they did some deep level studying, and then they chose a topic of their choice and did a project of their choice. So they could choose a video, they could choose a PowerPoint, they could choose a poster, whatever they felt comfortable with. And then a couple GEL students wanted to share a project they worked on, and I'm gonna let them share a little bit about that, because I know I have a couple kids who have to run off to practice, so.
I researched the church bombing of Birmingham, Alabama. One fact that I learned was Alabama was actually the most segregated state in the U.S. I think the most interesting thing I learned about this is, so four girls died, which means they never got to grow up or learn about anything, which I thought was very sad.
Hi, I did the emerald ash borer that is killing a bunch of trees, and one thing that I learned is that, like a lot of people, the trees have to get vaccinated to keep the bugs out and make sure they don't kill a tree.
Hi, I researched the emerald ash borer, and one thing that I enjoyed was having a Lakeville head forester coming to talk about trees and what we can do to save them. And then one thing I learned, that a bug that is so tiny can kill one tree.
I did research on Martin Luther King Jr. And I did it because he was very helpful with segregation. And one good, like, detailed thing I learned about him was that he helped a really bad time. And I didn't know that it was that bad, but it was like really, 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 really bad, because people were getting killed and arrested because of the color of their skin. And one thing I really liked was working with my partner and learning like teamwork. It was.
Hi, my name is Spencer, and one thing I learned about Martin Luther King Jr. was that he was a kid once, and he wanted to have the same freedom as other people, like white kids, and I liked hanging out with Carter and doing the project with him, and I didn't realize how bad segregation was until I did the research project.
Thank you. And the kids' names, I don't think they got to share, but we want to thank Callie and Campbell and Skylar and Spencer and Carter. And they all had some choice in the topic that they chose, so which made them so much more invested in the project. So it was great to see them kind of dig into something of interest. Thank you. Yeah.
Now it's Farmington Elementary School.
All right, thank you. We'll get the kids up here, but while they're getting up here, I'm Kim Bolison, principal at Farmington Elementary School. Thank you for the opportunity to come in. I'm excited I have to raise this. That's awesome. I'm usually lowering it for me. So we have some students and staff here that are excited to share some things we've been focused on at FES and being connected. We know relationships are so important as we talk about our school day and building relationships with students. So the last 2 years, we've really been focused on that at FES. We've been working with Seven Mindsets, which is a socially emotional curriculum, and we've been doing some extra things with them this year. Last year, we rolled it out with our staff, so they got a feel of it. This year, we included our students and families, so you saw some of the things that we're doing. But one of the things that is huge for us is we have been working with the Tiger Star program for years with our counselors, and it mends very well with that. And so Jen Venz has been a huge piece of that, of really incorporating some awesome experiences for our kids. So I'm going to hand it over to her and the kids so they can explain a little bit more.
All right, thank you. So one thing we've done in the past is we have a grade level day for each grade, and they've kind of, it's just mended real well with our seven mindsets. So before we do that, we did with our social emotional seven mindsets, we kicked off our year where we surprised our staff as well as the students by visiting every one of their homes. So here's a few pictures of that experience. I'm literally about 15 minutes before we left off, Mrs. Bolison shared with the staff that they were going to go visit every student. So we had the whole thing planned out. They were as surprised as the students were, but word got out. They met us on their bikes. They were really excited. On the top right picture, we also invited our retired teachers to come back, and that's Mrs. Pinter, and the mom on that student was her first grade student back at FES. So, and it was completely random, so that was a pretty cool experience. So, but back to our days. This year, we had our Passion First Day. This was our first experience with this. We did it with our kindergarten students. We had some of our high school students come down and share things they're passionate about. And this actually happened to be the same day as the girls' hockey state tournament, and we had about half our kids decide to still stay since they had committed to do that and share with our kindergarten students things they love to do. So everything from flying airplanes to building robots to fishing and to singing and dancing to playing sports. So they rotated through stations to learn about that. And then in the afternoon, they did a scavenger hunt on their iPads learning about staff passions. So our staff did videos of things they're passionate about outside of school, and then they had to match the name of the staff with the passion. We have some talented staff members too. Another thing we do is first grade and fifth grade buddies. So throughout the year, our fifth graders go down and partner up with our first graders. And at the end of the day, end of the year in May, we used to call it a stand-up day. We're going to call it the time is now. And we talk about being responsible. We talk about having self-respect, and we talk about taking care of ourselves and one another. And when we do that, then we get along better with other people. So we have a whole day focused on activities on that at the end of the year. And at the beginning of the year, throughout the year, I work with the fifth graders on that, and then they go teach that to the first graders. Second grade, we did Everything is Possible Day. So that day is focused on learning that you could do anything that you want to, no matter what your limitations are. We have guest speakers. We'll let Nick talk in just a minute, but he's been a guest speaker for the past 4 years. Right?
I've been since
first grade. Yeah, and actually spoke to his own students, his own grade level. We have community members come in and talk about things they persevered through, and then in the afternoon they do activities that are really hard for them to show that they can work through things that aren't easy. Fourth grade, we've had a kindness day. This has been like our longest running day. It's now our mindset of attitude of gratitude, so really focusing on being thankful for the things we have, being kind. And they go through stations all day just doing that. So whether it's writing thank you letters to teachers, whether it's working together doing teamwork games, they made bracelets this year, and that's a pretty cool experience. And then third grade, we have our We Are Connected Day. It's learning about being connected as a globally as citizens, kind of like a diversity day, and that'll be in April. And then in fifth grade, we have in May, we have our time is now with our first and fifth grade buddies. So each grade gets a t-shirt. So some of our kids have them. We're gonna send them home at the end of the year. We're gonna do a school-wide picture. Each grade has their own color. And then that's kind of the symbol of the mindset that they worked on. So kind of a cool experience. Any questions for our students at all? Or Nick, do you have anything you wanna share with your experience of going through this?
No.
No, okay. He might answer if you have a question for him, though. He said he would.
Yeah.
Anyone have any questions?
I think that's really neat that you guys did the community aspect with going out to the homes and meeting. I think that was a great touch.
Yeah, we had a teacher bring the idea to us last fall, and we lost a lot of sleep over it, but it worked out great. So that was cool. We kept it. There was only like five people that knew about it.
I bet you guys all enjoyed the project. Yeah?
And some of these guys, these fifth graders, have been through each one of these days then. So the point is that each year they go through a different day and a different mindset or Tiger Star characteristic. So they've been able to experience it, and then they get a t-shirt every year that goes through it too.
Very cool.
Very cool.
Good. Thank you for coming.
Yes, thank all of you.
Good evening. My name is Becky Biken, and I'm the principal at Meadowview Elementary. We are the last to go tonight, so thank you for your attention. I'm joined tonight by part of my special ed team who have worked very hard on putting together a mindful sensory space at Meadowview, and they have poured a lot of their own blood, sweat, and I don't think tears, but a lot of their own time into making that really a calming space for our kiddos at Meadowview. And I'm also joined by part of my kindergarten team tonight, who is part of a purposeful play pilot. And so we've got three of our kindergarten teachers working on using purposeful play, and they have seen some pretty remarkable things out of their kiddos with very creative, very divergent, open-minded creations in that time, and a lot of ability to team together. So I'll let them tell you a little bit about the background.
Does anybody want to share just a little bit? Most of what they shared was out there, and we weren't formally presenting anything, but
people first.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Julie Sieben. I'm one of the kindergarten teachers, and then I've got two other colleagues here. They'll introduce themselves.
I'm Kelsey Ashelson. I'm another one of the kindergarten teachers.
And I'm the other Kelsey. I'm Kelsey O'Dell on the kindergarten team. We started this. I'm one of the kindergarten and preschool teachers on the Young Learners Committee. And last year we were invited to read this book, and it was Purposeful Play. And when I was reading it, it seemed so intuitive that this is what we should be doing. Mm-hmm. But I think so many things get lost throughout our day. So it was kind of a reminder of what our 5 and 6-year-olds really should be doing throughout their day and how they can still have purposeful learning throughout it. So rather than giving up academic time, which I think a lot of people think, you know, you're playing more in the day, you have to be missing something. Instead of abandoning that, we're incorporating it. So a lot of the research in the book was showing us how and why combining these two aspects can be an asset. And I know personally for me, one of the assets that I found is having a lot of special education students in my classroom. These play times are times when everybody's included and everybody can bond, reach across, just experience different people, different ways of thinking, different ways of playing, and really having a truly included classroom.
So I'll let one of you go next. And when Kelsey showed me the book, it was like, this is what I've been waiting for. I have always
really did walk down the hall.
This is something I've been passionate about, my kindergarten class playing, not only at school, but also my three girls playing too. It's been such a huge part of their lives. And so for me, it was just kind of validation of, yes, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to incorporate in my classroom. And even though we've had lots of play, what this is doing is it's kind of focusing on having lots of different centers where the kids can communicate with each other, the kids can cooperate, they can use what we're learning, you know, with themes and incorporate that into play. Some of my favorite things, and some of you I shared out on our poster board, was, you know, we did a fairy tale theme where the kids were reading and retelling the Three Bears story. And so then when they got to go play in the morning, that's exactly what I probably had 6 kids who were building the Three Bears house and retelling it without any prompting from me. Mm-hmm. And it's also been helping too, especially at the beginning of the year when kids are nervous, not exactly sure how to ask someone to play. It's kind of their way of figuring out, you know, who's really good to play with, who likes the same things that I do, because it's kind of leveling the playing field, because everyone knows how, you know, they can find similar interests in things. And at the beginning of the year, I really kind of watched and guided some introductions and how do you ask someone to play, how do you, you know, someone's been playing and how do you jump into their play, and cooperating. You know, sometimes somebody's building a tower with blocks and the other friend wants to build a ship, and so it's trying to work together and things. And we've really seen a growth in our students as far as being able to communicate with each other and work cooperatively. And it's really my favorite part of the day. And I've been reading lots of books and lots of research. And I think I can't remember the exact quote, so I apologize for that. But they talk about how, you know, I can know you for an hour. Or I can know you for years and years and years, but if you play with me for 1 hour, I can know much more about you in that 1 hour of play than I could having a friendship with you for years and years. And that's so true with our students. They really find out a lot about each other just by playing with each other. So thank you.
So in our rooms too, we've kind of been piggybacking off of each other with how it looks in our classrooms too. And at first I kind of went to Becky and I was like, is it okay if we like play this much during our day? And it was kind of hard to kind of let go at first. And but then we were realizing, no, we can put, like, I have my Star Wars in the sand and we're incorporating a lot of what we're already learning into our play. And I know we first all started with a kind of a sign up chart. I'm still kind of using mine and slowly getting away, but I know in their classrooms they've gotten away from the sign-up charts and it's a little more open, and a lot of the centers are starting to kind of combine, like blocks don't have to just be at blocks. We can take, Julie used, told us earlier today, one of her students wanted to use a block as the telephone in her dramatic play area, so kind of putting all, letting the centers kind of mesh together. We find that there was, I can't remember the actual numbers, but I know that kids take in the dramatic areas and building blocks areas at least 45 minutes just to get deep into that thinking and playing. So instead of using a lot of just little 5-minute movement breaks throughout our mornings, we got rid of a lot of those and combined them just into one space where we had a lot more time to be able to play. I think we've all noticed a big benefit in just our learning times then when we're sitting down together to teach.
Are there any questions about kindergarten and our playtime stuff?
Madam Chair, if I could just make a comment. Oh. Having been in the district and having students that have been in either the half day or the full day program, when my child was in half day and then in full day, I know a lot of parents were very concerned about that piece, going from that half day and not having as much playtime and having that, you know, being more of a structured environment. And then there's the whole, you know, kindergarten is what our first grade was, probably you've heard many times. And just hearing that, I think it's just great to be able to pass on to the parents that they are doing play. So I hope I'd like to hear more about how it continues and see if it kind of spreads and affects around the district. It's great to hear. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, ladies.
Hi, I'm Christy Asmus. I'm an occupational therapist.
Lisa Cofield, special education teacher.
Diane Winquist, special education teacher.
Jenny Olson, special education teacher.
And we were part of the team that spent a year studying and doing research on sensory issues. And we also spent some time going out to other school districts or other adult facilities that have sensory rooms in their buildings, and then kind of work together with the research and what we found out and put together kind of our wish list of what we would like to have and the purposes behind the things that we have in the classroom or in the room that we have designated. And the reason we put it together is we just saw a need across our building for some self-regulation and sensory spaces for students to learn how to regulate themselves. And this space is not just for special education students. It is available to any student in the building that needs or has an identified need, whether their general education teacher has noticed a need, the school counselor uses it, she has students that she's aware of that she's identified. She also uses that space to hold some of her sessions in there. We have a video that was playing out there, and we have a variety of things out on the table. And So we have a couple guidelines to keep the room being used appropriately and safely. And we also have things around the building called brain breaks. And so we have the posters out there too for any student to use. If they need a break from the classroom, they can do a circuit around the building with specific stops to do some kind of a movement activity and then return to the classroom. And the goal is to keep students in the classroom and learning and working for more of their day rather than having issues and being sent out of the room. So, proactive, yes. Anybody else want to say anything or questions?
I think we do all these great things to make sure that kids can do their best learning. And if you are stressed and anxious, you are not soaking in anything that teacher is offering you. And so we really were intentional that school is hard for some kids, and you can't layer expectation upon expectation and never give a time to just And so we've really tried hard to let our kids feel supported in that way, that we care about who they are, and we care about helping them be the best they can be for their learning at school.
I also think we really put a lot of concentration on the different parts of sensory. I think we can all agree. We really dug into and studied, and with the help of our wonderful OT, we're able to look into what the needs are. It's not the same for every student. Their anxiety and their self-regulation or lack of can look so different. So I think we've tried to encompass in our sensory room just every part of that and try to meet or reach every student in their special way that they need to use the sensory room.
The only last thing I would add to that is that I think you guys have done an awesome job of making it a proactive space, as you kind of said. It's never a space where when somebody's having a really hard time where they go if they're kind of already melting down. We have separate spaces for that. So these are scheduled breaks that we know that kiddos that have certain sensory needs, that we know they're going to need it at certain times in the day. And so we try to support them by getting them into that space before we end up in a rough spot. So I think that's been really, really effective. And that's the way that it's been used across the board. So
I just want to say, I just think it's really, really awesome that it's available to all students. And it, having talked to you ladies, it kind of gives them an opportunity to realize their own self-care and like, this is what I need to get through the day when it's rough and things like that. And I think that is important even for elementary schoolers to be able to be that self-aware. So I think that's awesome.
And even to take that a little bit further, I kind of laughed when I saw the stress ball, I called it, with the colors. I'm tasked at my job to find some fun things for my employees. In all honesty, that's one of the objects, one of those stress balls with a color. And also I'm intrigued about that lava lamp, that little lava lamp. I mean, it's amazing how a little item like that doesn't just engage the kids, but I mean, I want to learn more about that little thing, but great job on that. But I mean, it's interesting, you hear what we take here from kindergartners to special ed. I mean, we do that every day in real life, and it's neat to see what we can, you know, I learning for that for my job right now, so I appreciate that, but what you guys do for the students, I thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Madam Chair, I had the opportunity to visit this on a boardwalk. One of my boardwalks, I can't remember when, and I just loved that room. I wanted to sit there all day, and I wonder if staff wants to sign up as well. But the question I had when you're talking about trying to utilize the space so you're anticipating the needs and it's not that high incidence, it's when they need that time to, you're trying to find out when to bring it before they escalate, way before that point. In some of those IEPs, cases where you're tracking students, have there been less incidences by being able to kind of be more in tune? Can you speak to that a little bit, any data or just, you know?
Yeah, I work with kindergarten, first and second grade. And so I had a few students in mind that I thought could benefit from it. And we've built just 5 to 10 minutes into the day. A couple of them, it was before specialist time. That tended to be a stressful time, so that's just their break, and then on to specialist, and it's gone really well. It's hard to really track the data for it, but just more and more time spent in specialist or during academic times overall, I've noticed. And then there were a couple of kiddos that room just was not appropriate. It really was not calming for them. It really got them more wound up. And so they use other things like the brain breaks in the hallway.
Thank you, appreciate that.
Sure.
Anyone else?
Great job.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
right, and our last group is from Gateway Academy.
All right, we're just going to switch computers. Hopefully this works.
Excuse me.
So while they're getting that set up, I'll just introduce myself. Hi, my name is Tim Schlatter. I'm a learning advisor at Gateway Academy.
Linda Island, learning advisor at Gateway Academy.
So we brought some students here that are going to share their personal project experience. For those of you that don't know what a personal project is at Gateway, basically each year we break it up into trimesters. And so each trimester a student pursues a project of their interest that they would like to learn more about. And they create this driving question, and then they do a bunch of research that, you know, gets at that driving question, and then they become that expert in that field. And then each trimester, we have this showcase where we present this information. And the past couple years, they've gotten, I would say, better and better. We're originally, when we first started off, we had projects that were, it was the first time some students were into this and like trying to figure it out. So they've definitely grown. Last year was kind of the first year where we saw some things happen where students are thinking about what they can leave behind and what they can help out for Gateway in the future. And so this year, it's a unique project that we've never done before. So it's kind of like an experiment where instead of having one personal project each trimester, we're trying with one project that lasts all year. And so these three, and then we had one more that couldn't make it tonight because of gymnastics. They decided to undertake this challenge, and it's ambitious, and I'm basically going to stop talking, and they're going to share a brief slideshow and go quickly through this. We don't want to take up too much of your time. Make sure you introduce yourself, please.
I'm Jameson Bowes.
I'm Blake Spanhauer.
I'm TJ Nielsen.
And our personal project this year is on building a shed.
Our driving question is, how can we as students of Gateway build a shed, store equipment, and bikes?
The reason we are doing this is there are another group of students at Gateway that are getting bikes, so our advisors told us we need a spot to store them, so we ended up deciding to build a shed.
In the first trimester, we basically kind of figured out what we were doing and what we would need to do to actually like build this, and, yeah. This is what kind of we learned in the first trimester briefly.
So basically for the foundation, we'll basically just get bags of concrete, or we'll just hire someone, we'll mix it up, and then we'll make a mold and whatever and dump it in.
Yeah, and then for the walls, we're going to take 2x4s and space them 60 inches apart, and then put some plywood on there and insulation. And then use house wrap and then put vinyl siding on there, so less maintenance, and, yeah.
And then for roofing, you want to attach trusses and then screw them into the studs. After that, you will use gusset plates and hurricane clips to secure it to the studs. After that, you will cover it with plywood and screwing. Once that, you will lay tar paper to and then staple it down to the plywood. After that, you will use shingles and then use half-inch nails to secure it down to the plywood. After that, you will lay caps on top of the roof.
Yeah, and we want this to be powered too, so our plan is to get like a solar panel up on the roof so it's green and everything. We want it powered so we can have like a light in there and an outlet to power like air compressor or any like electrical tools that we have. And then we figured out how to like wire lights and stuff. outlets. And then in the second trimester, or this trimester that just ended, we did fundraising. So we sent out letters to a bunch of companies. Right now we have a little over $300. So we also sent letters to some local construction companies asking if they could come out and help teach us how to like do things. And then the third trimester, we kind of just have to build it. We also have a digital model of our thing. Very cool. Yeah. So we use SketchUp Pro, and then we'll have on there, we'll have the 4 inches of concrete, and then below that, either 2 inches of sand or 2 inches of gravel to make so it doesn't break as easily or something like that. And then we'll have like a work table. And then we'll also have bikes, and then that pink stuff's supposed to be insulation, and then studs, and yeah.
So I would imagine through this process you guys learned about permits and codes and all that good stuff.
Yeah, that's also something that we need to do next trimester is get like permits and figure out what permits we need to get, and yeah.
Very cool. So right now it sounds like you're waiting for additional fundraising opportunities that come in, and then also people to help in general with building the shed. Okay. Anyone else have any questions or comments?
I must say, just knowing of this project in the very beginning and seeing how it's evolved, great job, guys. I know that you put a lot of research and a lot of time into this, and I am really excited about seeing this done.
Yeah.
And definitely keep us informed when you guys start building, and it's going to be a neat project to kind of follow through, and what a wonderful thing to leave for the other students. Mm-hmm. So good job.
Yeah, thanks. I think it's a great idea. Could you bring us like updated pictures when you see what stages you're going along? You got some builders here, Mr. Miller.
Oh, Madam Chair, I have a question real quick.
Yes.
I'm in need of a storage shed. As your next project, do you want to come to my house and help me build one? All kidding aside, I think this is a really cool project because it is, I mean, even if you don't go into the construction field, it's a talent that you guys are going to take with you for the rest of your life. And someday when you do own your own house, you're going to want to build that shed, and you're going to be able to know how to do it and know how to get the permits and do all that research. So kudos to you guys.
And thank you, Mrs. Ilum and Mr. Schlatter, for letting the boys do this. I'm sure, yeah.
It's a cool project. So just kind of as a suggestion, I know you guys were reaching out to contractors and different things to help with building it. There are some students at Farmington High School, I believe, that go to DCTC, and they actually build like a house at DCTC. So maybe you could reach out to your own peers at the high school and see if they'd be willing to come over and help you guys learn it, because they're learning at the college of how to build a house and shed, so maybe they could help you guys out.
Yeah, Thank Madam you. Chair, to clarify, that's Paul Landwehr is the teacher for the construction trades program, and he actually is a Farmington resident as well, so be a great connection. If you need help with that, let me know.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, good work. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Excuse me. All right, the next item under reports and communications is just an update on this meeting with the city administrator. And Mr. McKnight from the city administrator had reached out to Jay's office and wanted to set up a meeting. We don't have the intergovernmental committee anymore. When we restructured, we decided that wasn't a committee that we needed. And so, but he wants to convene and talk about the building maintenance issues and the tax impact with the ISC. In talking to Jay at our executive committee, thought it would be good if I also attended. I've not ever sat down with anyone from the city, and I thought having an additional board member would be good as well, and I thought perhaps Rebecca would like it because she's also new, and so she can maybe build those relationships as well. So that was just kind of my update to all of you. If you have any comments or questions or feedback,
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just to clarify, when we did the restructuring last year, the one discussion we had with kind of, it wasn't exactly, I mean, on the roster, it was eliminating the executive, I mean, eliminating the intergovernmental committee, but the discussion that was had at the time was that the executive committee would function with the city council and a couple city council members when those needs arise. At the time, we met, I think we met once or twice, and the piece was just to facilitate discussion and to plan the joint meeting that we typically have in the summer, which didn't happen this year, but that was one reason we had discussed that. So that was the process at the time for the thoughts, was that the executive committee could function as that, just to kind of clarify some.
Okay. No,
I'm you know, it's up to your discretion how you want to handle it, but that was kind of the thought at that time.
Okay. Well, and member Singwald isn't here, but we can certainly have a conversation at our next executive committee meeting as well, and then maybe bring that to our work session and get something set going forward as far as what we're going to do with those meetings and that committee. Sound like a plan? Okay. So then I will take a motion to, excuse me, acknowledge receipt of reports and communications.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Carrero, second by Souser. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. So reports and communications approved. Great. Next up is administrative action. We just have one item tonight. It's the approval of the personalized learning tech refresh lease agreement. And Mr. Andrew Baldwin is going to present for us on that.
Hey, thank you, Chair Doyle, members of the board. So yes, I'm here to present the personalized learning tech refresh report. Proposal, which as you recall is a work session topic that we also had back in February. So the reason why we're bringing it forth to you here in March, as a reminder, is we're trying to leverage some timing to our advantage. Apple is motivated to try and have this happen in their third quarter. And if we have an opportunity to place it here with current products, we also know that there is potential. Apple just announced today they have an announcement on the 25th. Historically, Apple comes out with their iPad-related products here at the end of the month. And so we're looking to leverage that. It works for our advantage because Apple, the last couple of years, anytime they offer a new product, that new product becomes available immediately, which means that we would then be replaced with the newest product. If a new product is not released, we will not move forward with a sixth gen iPad, which was introduced in 2018. So to that end, with the other things about doing some things pending board approval on that, the potential of lining things up here in the spring gives us the potential opportunity to perform a spring swap. Part of this proposal also includes the third-party services that Apple will coordinate for us in terms of casing the device, getting rid of the debris and recycling that equipment, getting them cased, which means following our testing season where students take standardized tests and such on the iPad, we get past that window in May that we potentially could have a spring swap of these devices. The other nice thing about this, it also includes the refresh of laptops for our current fleet, which dates back to a 2012 model on there, as well as addressing some of our classroom and learning space technology needs that are still making use of desktop computers in there as well. Again, this one represents a lease purchase, which is what we just completed. That lease purchase means that we own equity in those devices from that standpoint. And so this $857K annual payment actually represents about $97,000 less than what we had paid our last go-around for those last 3 years, in addition to additional equipment in there, so that's advantageous. And because we are exiting out of a lease purchase, that means we have equity in our current fleet of devices. If we get approval at this point moving forward, and it's contingent upon a new device being released and we move forward on that one, we're looking to the sale of our current hardware devices, which means if we can get that done before June, before Apple has their worldwide developer conference, typically I think they've already announced like June 3rd, they often announce when the next operating systems out, what the system requirements are on that, and we potentially will have a greater resale value on our current hardware. The other advantage is we can also get to market before other schools do their summer refreshes. And so it's all about that. There's a lot of unknowns still on that. If Apple does not come through with a new hardware purchase, we'll rescind our order for that standpoint, and we'll make use of these iPads for another year to that end. The other caveat to this is potentially the rumor sites, they say they might have a form factor change on the iPads. They might not. If there is a form factor change, there's sometimes delays due to manufacturers getting the specs to rev up cases in time. As you're probably aware, Apple does a fair job of keeping things very secretive until they have products released. So we'll see how that comes. This would be kind of like that first proverbial domino to fall in terms of the sequence of things that would happen on there. And again, as I said, we would rescind if conditions change and they don't come out with a new product on this. But the recommendation from administration would be to approve this quote at this time. Questions that I may also answer for you.
I just have a couple of comments. The retaining the Mac Pros for subs that we talked about, I think that's huge for the district on that. Do you know how many are there?
We have a fleet. So Board Member Carr was speaking about our current fleet of 2012 MacBooks. We have about 260 of those. They're only going to decline as they tend to fail. We've already done a fair amount of lack of a better way to say it, Frankensteining of parts, making those extended. We'll certainly use those things for our subs as we move to mobility here with our teachers in the classrooms. Our substitutes in these spaces are going to need devices, so they're worth more to us to retain those, use those, strip them down so they're lightweight, run in a browser so they can get access to certain things there. Some other ideas we've had is also in talking to Marianne and HR, at one point we had like 78 teachers out on a given day, so that's significant. So we need that balance of devices in there. Other things I'm interested in doing, also ran it by Mr. Pickens, is this notion of that potentially we could have these devices available for checkout for students or courses that may want to use those. And again, if we look at stripping those things down, if kids are interested in doing some Xcode things on there or Swift kinds of things, then we're presenting an opportunity for our kids to have access to the Windows operating system with some of the things that they're doing, and also on the macOS side of things.
And just overall, again, great details on this. I do commend you for getting that preferred Apple Care for a year for included.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's, you know, $16,000 that we don't have to dish out. And we get a designated person for the district on it. Oh, two?
We'll get two. Yep, so for 1 year, and Board Member Kerr is referring to the Apple Care professional services on there. So we have unlimited. Typically in the first year when you do a refresh, particularly if there's a new model, you encounter some unanticipated kind of technical issues. And this would provide us an opportunity to have a case manager support, unlimited instant reports with this. And then it also provides, as we look at our technical staff as well, providing the opportunity to resources to have access to additional Apple training for their Apple certification training for a year also. Yes, and so we would only do it for the 1 year, and it's no additional cost to the district to have that.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Thank you for all of your details previous to this board meeting to help us be prepared. I appreciate that.
Absolutely.
One quick question, I think I answered it online, but I thought I'd ask anyway. The JAMP Pro or JAMFP Pro, can you tell me what that is?
Sure, so the JAMP Pro, and you'll notice on that quote that you received, we list it in year by year, so it's on there four times for each of the OS, iOS and the Mac OS on that. We did that strategically. JAMP has shifted to a cloud-based piece, and we came back and said, we're not paying for a cloud-based subscription service that's higher when we don't see the advantages currently to do it through the cloud. So please see if you can give us the current structure we have. So they had a different model. They had to list it 1 year at a time, so that refers to our 4 years. The JAMP is our management system. It allows us to provide some remote control of these devices, both for iOS and Mac OS.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jack, go ahead.
I don't know, I might have missed this, but with the 2012 MacBooks, are all the teachers going to be getting new MacBooks? And if so, what model year would we be looking at?
So we're looking, and so we've So we'll be looking at the newest model that was introduced, which was in October of 2018, the iPad Air. We've also taken a look at what are the curricular needs on that. So it would not be universally all Mac OS devices on there. Certainly things where there's special services on there. We've got some tech ed kind of needs on that. The high school spoke to some business ed kind of needs on there. But there's certainly some advantages in terms of leveraging the volume purchase with iOS. One of our motivations as well is because we are focusing and centering off our personalized learning, which is the iOS device. Not surprisingly, there's a lot of continuity kind of advantages with staying with the Apple ecosystem. So the Mac OS allows for AirDrop communication of things back and forth. A lot of the interoperability of platforms on there. One, for example, we'd like to, if this moves forward, is provide Notability, which has been a huge mainstay on our iOS. They make it for Mac OS, which would also facilitate kind of that movement back and forth of documents as well. With this particular purchase, it would be a volume purchase in terms of MacBook Airs for a significant number of our teaching staff. And then we'll also have to augment in terms of our budgets we have for some personalized learning and classroom technology and augment with some Windows 10 based machines.
Perfect, thank you.
All right, any other questions? All right, thank you, Andrew.
Yeah.
With that, I will entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the lease purchase agreement between Farmington Area Public Schools and Apple Incorporated as presented.
Second.
Take my pick. Motion by Guerrero, second by Souser. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, motion carries. And then finally, we have board remarks. So I'll start down with Member Carrero.
A couple of things. The last two weekends, I know, we had two sport teams have MYS state tournaments. And I know, again, the compliments of the facility, Dan, on your staff, of how they keep it. Absolutely, by far, everybody loves coming down here for one of these tournaments. And again, I know they had snow on this past Sunday. They did a phenomenal job getting that wet, heavy stuff out. And also, I attended the Tiger Fan Club meeting the other night, and the section we hosted a section gymnastics event at the high school. And an interesting tidbit about that is, and hopefully I say this right, the boys basketball and boys hockey team actually help unload the vehicles or help unload the equipment out of the vehicles. Mm-hmm. Because they had to rent equipment to come in for the section tournament on that. I guess it was a pretty significant manpower, so I commend those sports on that. And also robotics. I know we're up in Duluth this past weekend with that lovely snowstorm. I'm not sure how they did, but I knew they were doing pretty well on that. And again, what makes these board meetings when we have the teachers and students come in and speak, I'll tell you, it makes it for a fun evening, so I appreciate them coming. That's all I have.
All right, Rebecca.
Absolutely. Thank you to whoever sets up all the kids coming with the teachers. Because I think it's amazing to talk to the kids and see how passionate they are about what they're doing, what they're learning, and how they're incorporating it. And I thought it was incredible. I know you mentioned this, Steve, with the girls and the boys that were doing the play and how they overcame their fear. And now they've like, I'm really excited now. And that just really hit home because there's so many kids that are so afraid to speak in public, and I think it was just a wonderful way to incorporate that. I will say, this past last week, my son Nathan had a medical event, and I would just like to really thank Nurse Teddy over at Dodge. She was absolutely amazing. They ended up having to call 911, and boy, I tell you, she's a rock star. And thank you to Carl, the vice principal over there. He took care of everything. And I was very impressed because Friday morning I got a phone call checking up on him when it was a staff development day. And I thought that was wonderful. And I got a phone call from Teddy today. So I tell you what, if there's ever an emergency need with any students in the district, it's a good place to be. They were amazing. So thank you to them because I don't know if they get thanked enough.
Jake, go ahead.
First, I'd just like to echo what Steve said. These
meetings where we have students and staff come to present are the most fun meetings we have throughout the year. So I've really enjoyed that. And thank you to all the students and staff who presented tonight. I really think, kind of like I said before with the shed project, one theme that I saw throughout all of these presentations was the lifelong skills these students are going to take with them. And whether it's overcoming their fear of public speaking or building a shed or researching buildings around the community, it's amazing skills that they're going to be bringing with them. And one other theme that I noticed in all of those presentations was just the connection with the overall community, whether it was visiting with businesses or working with various funding sources for the projects throughout the community. It's amazing how interconnected we're becoming. And then finally, it's almost spring break. So for all the students and staff, I hope you have a fun spring break and you stay safe.
Well, I just want to say thank you, first of all, with the students and staff that came here tonight, just like what everyone else has been saying. Also, I want to thank the bus drivers and all the school staff, like janitors, cafeteria ladies, and other people who's been helping and trying to make every school better and clean and safe. Also, I just want to say that everyone have a happy spring break.
Jack?
Kind of hard to follow all you guys. You're hitting all the topics, but thank you to all the peers and staff that came out today. It was really cool seeing the different projects and the different way that we're beginning to learn here in Farmington. It's really cool to see the development from when I was in those grades to what they're doing now. And just thank you and good job to all the students. It's really cool to see that. And also I'd like to give a big thank you to Mr. Miller and everyone at the buildings, because walking through the parking lots at the high school, it's safe. And given the conditions that we've had these past couple of weeks, I know that's really difficult. So they're doing an amazing job clearing the snow and making it safe for all the students to get to class. So thank you very much for that. But yeah, it's just really cool to see the different students and everything and the way that it's working here in Farmington.
Melissa.
Well, first of all, I think one of the coolest things in the meeting today was when we did the Pledge of Allegiance and we heard all the students give the Pledge of Allegiance. And one thing I think it'd be neat to start, I mentioned this one time a while ago, I would love to have groups of students come in and lead us in the pledge at each of our meetings. There's no reason why we can't be inviting different clubs, different grades to come in and lead it, because I know having been past chair, you kind of get tired of starting every time, and having this group of students here was just a great example of how exciting that moment of the meeting can be. So I just want to put a plug in for that again, because that would be neat to see. Second, we mentioned it was Paraprofessional Recognition Week. I am just so grateful for all the paraprofessionals that have worked with my child, and I know how much effort they put for all the children in the district that needs it, and it's a labor of love. They spend so much time with the students that need those services, and I want to thank every single one of them for the time that they have given and will do, and I know many times they're spending hours that they're not paid for to help out our students, and I want to thank them for that from the bottom of my heart. The third thing, we're still in science fair season. I've been able to judge a couple. I've judged another one this week. I think it's the final one, but I love coming to science fairs and learning what the students are doing. So many of them are driven by passions that they have in projects that they're really curious about. What happens if this, or if I do this, how will that change? And it's just so neat. So thanks for those invitations. Keep them coming, love coming in. And fourth, just putting a plug in, next week there's a lot of music events going on. Monday the 18th is the band Jubilee Day, so you get kind of the preview from the fifth grade to the middle school to the end of the high school. Great event at the gym. And then the next day is Choir Palooza. Same thing, you get kind of a preview of all the different choirs at the schools. And beforehand, I believe they're having a pasta dinner to help support the choir program. So find out that if you want to know more. So that's what I've got for tonight. Thank you.
Yeah, there's not much additional that I can say.
It's hard going last.
Yeah, but I do, we all appreciate the students and the staff and the parents that come in and share with us. Jay, I just want to thank you again for all the traveling that you've been doing and the work that you've been doing promoting the district and what we do.
We always appreciate that. And I can't speak for all the buildings, but I know FES specifically had conferences. I don't know if all of them did, but thank you to those teachers that stay late and put in that extra work and keep all of us parents updated on what's going on with the kiddos. So with that, I will take a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting at 7:53.
Second.
Motion by Cordes, second by Carrero. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Meeting adjourned.